First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. Back once again with Dr. Aleem Bey. And tonight's show is going to be called Kundalini Activation and also Receiving Your Galactical Name. We're going to go into some new information or some information that you might not have heard elsewhere. But it's going to explain a lot of things. So we're going to get into that right now. Whenever it comes to the Kundalini, you know it as the Mother Goddess Principle. In pictorial form, it is the Black Madonna. It is also referred to throughout nature, or throughout the course of nature, as being Mother Earth in one aspect. It is also set within the ancient Kemetic teachings, or Tamarayan or Tibetan or Kemetic teachings. Or said other name is called Mary, or said Mary. Mary, of course, becomes the mother of God, known as Jesus, the Queen of Heaven. And of course, the word Mary means see, or either illusion, hence symbolic to or representation of the matrix. And what you must use in order to break through the matrix or pierce the illusion, and that is the Kundalini itself, as it raises up through the seven caves, or what is known as the seven centers, seven melanin centers, seven conscious seats, seven stages of consciousness, seven seats of light, whatever term that you want to refer to it as, and also known as the seven Elohim, the seven eyes of Allah, known as the seven chakra system, or major chakra system, which are your endocrine glands. What happens is that as you pierce through each of these, and there's also techniques that can actually, the Kundalini can be raised without going through the particular chakras, and that might be necessary for some people based on the current environment in which that we live in, based on so much guilt, so much disappointment, fears, frustrations, hatred, so forth and so on. You might want to bypass that, the lower chakras in particular, as which is taught by my grandmaster Sunyata Saraswati, the author of Jewel in the Lotus. He recommends that that is done in the beginning stages, definitely, because of all the latent, dormant, negative energies in which that you have collected, or the debris in which that you have become familiar with living in this particular environment and society. So, one of the things in which that you can definitely do is to learn one technique in particular in which that you can be initiated into. It's called the Cobra Breath Technique, or the Cosmic Cobra Breath Technique, in which that Master Sunyata initiate people into. Now, when it comes to the Cobra Breath Technique, there's several sciences concerning that. As a matter of fact, when it comes to that, there's seven initiations. Four of them can be given by Master Sunyata, and the last three by Baba G on the astral plane. Of course, some of y'all might think that is something, you know, spooky, but that's because people think that they are only humans. You know, you heard the song, "I'm only human, flesh and blood, I'm man." So if you come with that ideology or that thought process, then of course you're missing the boat. And you're going to miss it, because the information concerning the Cobra Breath Technique is actually an oral lineage that is actually passed down from teacher to teacher for thousands of years. It is normally passed on by word of mouth, and it's never been actually written. And it shouldn't be written. The reason for this is, you know, one of responsibility. If you think about it, because of the oral tradition, the teacher must always meet the student in person. You know, so that information can be passed on. So if you go to the Shindao website by Grandmaster Sunyata Saraswati, you can actually go to him or when he's going through the various states doing his lectures, you can meet up with him and actually possibly get that initiation into the Cobra Breath Technique. There's actually a tradition in which that is strictly adhered to for reasons of self-safety in manipulating the Kundalini energy, because the Kundalini is the most powerful energy in the body, and there's nothing to trifle with. You know, this ancient breath technique, you know, was held secret because of its great power. You know, as a matter of fact, when my wife and I became students of his in 2005, it was weeks before we received the Cobra Breath Technique. And actually, you had to be advanced in order to even get it from him. You had to go through, you had to have gone through some type of energy modality school or system, Reiki, Pranayama, what's called Pranic Healing, or whatever the case may be. Right, and then he took you on as a student, and then you might have been able to get the particular work done. But you had to also be skilled. Also, you know, you had to study Qigong, Tai Chi, several things. All right, and actually, you know, Master Sunyata is like, you know, he spent over, you know, 50 years. You know, learning these techniques. And he actually met Yogananda, the author of the autobiography of a yogi, when he was a child. You know, and so this lineage is said to go back thousands of years, originating with a spiritual master named Maha Avatar Baba G. So Baba G is also credited with being the originator of the chant Om Namah Shivaya, which is a powerful and mantra in which that opens the heart. The cobra, of course, other name is the Naga. So really what you're doing is receiving the Naga meditation or the Naga initiation. And this is actually how you become a Naga. In which that, of course, we get the origin of the word nigga. Or Niger. Or Nigeria. All right? Now, if you need more information on this, there's a book out right now in which that dealt with this. It's called Nigger, a Divine Word. I think it was by Sister Shabaka. And y'all can check that book out. Also, you can get the videotape, Africans in Asia. As well as you can get my videotape, in which that me and Brother Bobby Hemi did on the Kundalini. I think it was called Global Ascension and Kundalini Rising, something like that. And we break down that information on the Kundalini, go more into detail. I actually show the various words throughout the various languages and dialects of the world and how it relates back to the word Naga, in which that is the serpent force. The word Kundalini itself means the serpentine fire, and the Kundalini is the life force of the consciousness. It is also the sexual energy. So when the sexual energy is aroused, the serpent climbs up the spinal column to the higher centers of the brain, expanding the consciousness. And of course, the cobra snake is chosen specifically because it flares at the head before it strikes. And so this act symbolizes the expansion of consciousness. This is why on the tiaras or the crowns of the pharaohs and pharaohs or kings or queens or emperor or empresses of Ethiopia, as well as also on up into Egypt, this particular symbol was utilized. As a matter of fact, you will find the symbol in the Americas. It was known as Quetzalcoatl, Kukulcan, Gutamas, which was known as the feathered serpent. So, this where this information stems from is from, and I mean, if you study Buddhism, you would see the same information. You would see Buddha sitting in a meditative position, in a lotus position, legs crossed, and seven cobras around his head, symbolic to the activation of the seven chakras. And that's what we mean by these seven levels or styles of the cobra breath. You know, teachers teach the first four levels. That's what Master Sanyata teaches. And the other three must be intuitively picked up by the student and confirmed by teachers of the lineage. Okay? So when the sexual energy moves upward, it enlightens you. In normal sex, you know, the energy flows downward to drain you. The cobra breath reverses the flow of the sexual energy to turn it into a most valuable resource because it deals with the body and the signs of rejuvenation. The Kundalini energy can rejuvenate the body and empower the mind and to awaken the soul. All right? All said is symbolized as the Holy Spirit, which is actually the Kundalini itself at the base of the spine as it raises up. And it hits the pineal gland, which the soul itself is embedded inside. It awakens Osa. This is what it meant by the resurrected Osa. And the penis in which that was once lost or was formed from clay by Tahuti. It itself is the pineal gland. As a matter of fact, the word pineal and penal, as in the head of the penis, is one and the same. As a matter of fact, when the Kundalini goes into the brain area, the third ventricle area, and it enlightens the pineal gland, it also becomes engulfed in blood, and it swells up, and it looks just like the head of the phallus, the penis, except there's like 144,000 crystal-like sand particles, which is magnetic, in which that sits around it, in which that beams energy upward, which is the Kundalini, into a galaxy-looking cloud over top of the third ventricle over the pineal gland, and it looks, and it's sideways, it looks like a UFO. Now, this can be proven if you go to the 15th page in Dr. Layla Africa's book called Nutricide. He shows a picture of the brain being blown up to the equivalent size of a car. And he shows this galaxy-like looking cloud there, which looks like a UFO. Well, this is like beam me up, Scotty. And so the Kundalini is beamed up from the pineal gland into that particular galaxy-like cloud. This is the same scenario in which that you would see on Men in Black Part 1 with the cat Aurea, with the constellation called Orion, with that constellation galaxy like a cloud inside of that particular ball around the neck of the cat, Orion. So they was already giving up particular jewels. And basically what that means is that you have access to intergalactical travel. Okay, and see, this is the thing which a lot of people don't understand, or overstand, is that this is not spookism. We just told you that you can actually see the brain being blown up to the equivalent size of a car in this galaxy-like looking cloud over top of the pineal gland. That's not spookism. That is real. You can see that with your own two eyes. But the problem with people who think that is spookism is because they don't know these particular things about the human body and what each particular organ do, but yet they can scream astrology, or they have gone to school in order to learn astronomy and pay someone $20,000 in order to tell them that they come from a monkey instead of $20,000 in order to tell them that they come from God. I haven't received no $20,000 in order to tell you that you come from God, and I think I'm one of the best ones out here in order to damn break this shit down to you. But you would go to a school in order to get taught that you're a monkey, that you come from a fucking ape, and respect that shit and don't question it. But then come and question what I'm saying and act as this shit is some spookism. Well, you go and find me the goddamn missing pieces of this ape shit into human shit, and then we can talk about some shit. And once you do that, then we can talk. Because I just proved to you that we have a galaxy-looking cloud over top of our pineal gland. I can show you a picture of that, an actual picture. But you can't show me a picture of the missing link, because scientists have not found it. They don't have that. That's why they're still speculating. That's why it's still a theory in search of God. But haven't found God yet, because that's what the word theory means. Theo means God. And they haven't found God yet. And they're not going to find God in no eight. Not in that way. The breath of life itself is an aspect of the soul or God. But it's not God in its totality, in which that you have access to, as being the epitome of God on planet Earth, after the image and after the likeness of God on Earth. But anyway, the breath itself, which is called Shu, as in Jesus' name, Yahshua, or the English transliteration of the name, Joshua, which means, oh, he who saves, or the Lord is my salvation. The Lord in which that is referring to is the breath. The breath is the salvation. Because the breath pulls the Kundalini Shakti or magnetic energy up into the spine, charging the electromagnetic properties of the cerebral spinal fluid, allowing the Kundalini to move up the spine. And as the brain is bathed in the magnetized fluid, the nervous system is transformed. And you awaken to a new consciousness. That's what is symbolic to the wing disc. The wing disc. And if you haven't seen it, I'm sure you have. If you go to the hospital, you have. Symbolic of a healer. Used during the third dynasty by Imhotep. That was one of his symbols. Within the Sumerian text, it was called Nagal. Nagal utilized that same symbol of the Uraeus, or the Ueshet, or Washetet, or Washet, which is Aten, which is that the sun disk with the wings at it, hanging out at the ends of each other, symbolic to the expansion of the mind, or the expansion of consciousness, or the activation of the right and the left hemisphere of the brain, giving you 100% usage of the brain instead of just the 10% in which that you have been taught and have been blocked into or boxed into. Hence the reason why we say that you for those who put God into a box. So, you'll find out that the first level of the cobra breath can be used solely as a meditation on practice. However, only level one is used in love making as well. It is the only one safe, secure, comfortable, or easy and reliable method for postponing an orgasm or ejaculation that allows one to remain totally present. Thus, you can become the master of your sexuality instead of a slave to your passions. This technique combines with other tantric or Taoist sexual practices will improve the quality of your sex and intimacy life for the rest of your days and nights. We say orgasm and ejaculation because once this technique is mastered, the man can actually have an orgasm without having ejaculation. Or he can have an ejaculation without having an orgasm. Yeah, I know this is difficult to understand, right? This is some more spookism. I know, because you don't know the human body. This efficiently eliminates the problems of the pre-ejaculation or the premature ejaculation. And it magically allows the men and women to have their bodies, mind, and spirits in the same place at the same time. So when you are totally present, and you have your heart open, it dissolves the ego, and you will find and you'll go to a divine place. And some of you have been there, you know, for a few moments, sometime in your life. You might have recognized it, you might not have recognized it. But it's definitely some place in which that you want to go back to. It's actually the state of mind. It's called nirvana, or what is called heaven. And you can reach that while here in the flesh, because the body is the temple of God. 1 Corinthians 3:16. So, you have to understand these particular sciences that we're talking about. This cosmic cobra breath technique is something in which that you definitely want to practice and learn. You know, as a matter of fact, once you get the particular initiation into it, we're pretty sure that Grandmaster Sanyata will actually teach you or tell you how many times he recommends to practice. Right? Sometimes it's recommended from 14 to 21 on cobra breath each day. You know, you may divide it into, three groups of seven cobra breaths over the day. It's an amazing, powerful circuit of energy that may be set up in the body if you practice it daily for 3 months, especially. And then using the fire breath orgasm in conjunction with the cobra breath will accelerate the removal of blockages, preventing the flow of the life force energy through the chakras, energy centers. The longer you use it, the more powerful it becomes. 3 breaths in 3 years may be as powerful as 14 breaths in year one. Basically, what that means is that it removes karma. It quickens the mind. This is the quickening in which that the Bible speaks of. It's also known as the opening up the inner fluids, the channel through which that the chakras will be retained by the body no matter how long one may discontinue to practice. It's like learning how to ride a bike. You'll never forget. So So this is one of the things in which that you definitely want to practice. Of course, some would go or move towards Kundalini yoga, in which that is good also. But this is some of the best ways to practice. I recommend that you get the book, Jewel in the Lotus, by Grandmaster Sunyata Saraswati, Tao of Sexology by Stephen Chang, and Sexual Reflexology by Mantak Chia. Those are basically the three best books that I can recommend. All right. So now, once you reach these particular levels, you can actually get your galactical name. This is something I wish that isn't talked about often. But the ancient Egyptians believed that the human soul was made up of nine parts. One of those parts was the Ren, R-E-N. And as a part of the soul, a person's Ren or name was given to them, of course, at birth. Because that's the energy in which that was picked up through the mother and father as the child was coming in 3 months prior to or so. And the Egyptians also believed, also believed that it would live as long as the name was spoken. And so, as long as the name was spoken, the individual, the person, spirit lived. That soul lived. Which explains why efforts were made to protect it and to practice, and the practice of placing it into numerous writings. For example, part of the Book of Breathings, which is a derivative of the Book of the Dead, which is misnomer the Book of the Dead, which is actually called the Book of Coming Forth by Day and Night, was a means to ensure the survival of the name. So a magical rope was formed called it was used to surround the name and protect it. That's what it was used. It was a magical rope. It was like a circle, a magical circle. When people go into performing ceremonies, invoking spirits, they put a circle of protection around themselves. Well, this magical rope was also used to surround the name. As a matter of fact, the pharaoh had up to five names. Right? Like, for example, we give a good example. When it comes to the name, like the name of the deceased enemies of the state, such as like Unkhunten, was hacked out of the monuments in the form of damnation. All right. Even though we've found plenty of information and evidence on him and his son, Tutankhamun, or Tutankhamen. But what happens is that these names, and in particular your galactical name, and as a matter of fact, what happens is once you reach a certain level of consciousness, you can ask the ancestors or your higher self, which is actually connected to your oversoul, where your incarnations or lives are located at. You can ask them, what is your galactical name? And it will reveal your galactical name to you. I give you a good example too, is that in 1998, I was practicing a lot of Reiki and pranic healing. And I guess because of what I was practicing, being that it was every day, almost all day, I was doing these practices, that the ancestors would say, okay, well, we're going to bestow upon you, you know, knowledge of your galactical name. Well, I received my name in a dream or in a vision. And I was told what it was by my higher self. And then upon waking up or getting up, I was trying to remember the exact spelling so that I can go and do research. Because they don't give you something in order that you can't research. So I was sitting there trying to remember. And the sister who was staying with me at the time, and her husband and all of them was staying with me at the time, she came out and she said, "Well, what you doing?" I said, "I'm trying to remember, you know, what the ancestors was telling me, you know, what my name was, you know, but basically, you know, how to spell it." And she comes out and she sits down and she said, "Okay, well, maybe I can help you." Bam, out of all the trillions of words, you know, over eons, she said the name of which that they told me. And so that was confirmation right there within less than 10 minutes of who I was galactically. I give another good example. My Kundalini came to me in a dream. It was more so a vision once again. And she and I were sitting at an airport, and we was talking, and we was looking at the planes fly or ascend. And essentially what she was telling me is that she was ascending within me. And so I asked her what was her name. She wrote it down on a piece of paper, a notebook, and I looked at it and I said it. And as soon as I said it, she touched me, and I actually orgasmed. Or had a wet dream in real life. And so I said, okay, I had to remember how to spell that name. And of course, I woke up and went to the library, do some research. Come to find out that the name that she told me was equivalent in ancient times to the name Kundalini. So, your body parts, your chakra system, your seats of light, your seats of consciousness, all of these things convey and speak to you via dream and visions. This is something in which that a lot of people don't understand and realize, because a lot of times when we go to sleep at night, you know, we have what's called bitch dreaming. In other words, we're concerned about what happened that day. So we are complaining subconsciously about what is going on. So you don't have time in order to find out the real essence of who you are, because you're just so busy bitching about what took place. And so your mind or your consciousness have to try to find some type of result for you, some type of solution for you. And sometimes that comes through the dream world. Now, we got to, I'm going to go to the phone lines right quick. We got area code 347. Area code 347, you're on the line. Peace.
Peace, peace, guys. It's Jason. I sent you the sweater.
Yeah, thank you, bro. I had it on yesterday. Thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate it, man. I appreciate all the information you was giving out. And, you know, one of the first audios I heard on YouTube was about the Olmecs, and really inspired me to do some artwork on it. So I definitely had to send you one. So I respect that and appreciate that.
I appreciate you, know,
you. Yeah, but I had a question about the cobra breath. Are you going to be able to do some exercises today?
Well, we're going to do some exercises, but it's not going to be the cobra breath, but we will be dealing with some techniques in which that can help activate the Kundalini. One in particular, since you asked for, let's get into that right now. Some of y'all might have seen this technique, which I've shown before. It was on the Charmin Hillis DVD or video, in which that you would take your left hand and place it at the base of your spine, which is right above the crack of your behind. And then you would take your right hand and move up in concessions along the chakra system, your seven major chakras. So you would go at the genitalia, the navel chakra, the solar plexus, the heart, the throat, the third eye, and the crown. And while you still have your hand at the base of your spine symbolizes the bowl of the kundalini. This is where the kundalini dwells at, called the kunta bowl. The kunta bowl. This golden bowl is also mentioned within Ecclesiastes, where it speaks about the sword and the golden bowl. The golden bowl is talking about the kunta bowl, which is the kundalini, which is the bowl of the serpentine fire. This is where the energy, your personal life force energy, dwells at. This is the concentration of all the universal, of the universal life force in your physical manifestation, in the physical form, in your anatomy. So what you're doing is manipulating it, and you're helping it to move up in concession along the endocrine glands. And you, and the more that you move your hand, your right hand, up along the front of the body, along the endocrine glands, you would get hotter and hotter and hotter in concession. This symbolizes the burning away of the karma within those particular chakras, or what is called the burning forth of the threads, called ethereal threads. And those threads are being burnt as the kundalini moves up through the chakra system.
Is that similar to the burning bush?
Yes, that is the burning bush. That is exactly what that is symbolic to, because it says that the bush was on fire, but yet it did not become consumed. Well, your body is at 98.6 degrees, and the kundalini, as the energy comes up, you will feel even hotter. But the thing is that actually your body is still at a constant temperature of 98.6 degrees, but the heat is coming through by way of the burning. And so your physical body symbolizes the bush, or the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and you learning how to master the knowledge of the tree of life, as we would say. Because remember, there were two trees in the garden. The tree of knowledge of good and evil is actually symbolic to the knowledge in which that you have of good and evil, positive and negative, disagreeable and agreeable. In other words, you're able to see the dichotomy or the dualism within nature, within the world. But when you reach the tree of life, there is no duality. There is only one. In other words, when the lower nature is merged into the higher nature, there's only one self. There's only one nature. So you must merge the lower self, which is called the lower mind or the lower nature, into the higher mind, the higher self, the higher nature. And once that is done, that is the symbolic of the ancient Egyptians, where they showed you, or the ancient Tamarians, where they showed you, or the Kamals, of the bringing together of your red crown and the white crown. The red crown symbolized lower Egypt, and the white crown symbolized upper Egypt. And that symbolized the lower self, which is Set, the color red, hence the reason why they say Satan or the devil is red. Him, symbolic to desires, the depths of hell. All of that is symbolic to the lower nature, which is the three lower chakras in particular. And then the meeting part point between the red and the white is the heart chakra. And then the white symbolizes the three higher chakras, which is the immortal body. So that is the bringing together of the red and white crown. So the ruler over lower and upper Egypt. That is
got you.
Right. This is when you see the symbol of Aten with the winged disc, the expansion of the mind, of the consciousness. That's when that happens.
I think I heard you say that the serpent in the Bible was a metaphor for your kundalini.
That's exactly right.
So why do they make it seem so demonic in the Bible? Is that
because, if you heard me earlier, I made mention of the fact that you had to be careful about raising it up through the chakra system. if you raise it up through the chakra system and you have all this guilt and frustration and anger and disappointment and all these things lodged within your dormant or latent within your chakra system, then only thing it's going to do is magnify it as it comes up. And you don't want magnified anger. You don't want magnified frustration, disappointment, depression, hatred. You don't want those things. So you have to mentally eliminate those things from out your subconscious through what is known as prayer, through decrees, positive affirmations, words of power, chants, mantras, whatever term that you want to refer to them as. You have to develop some type of mind power in order to eradicate or suppress those to the point where they are almost irrelevant or neutralized or murdered. Those attributes have to be murdered within yourself because they are all stemming from fear. So fear has to be eliminated from out your psyche as much as possible so that when the kundalini energy rises, it can rise in splendor.
So you have to dissolve it, basically.
Right, you have to dissolve it. Matter of fact, when it comes to, if you go to the justice lessons of the Nation of Gods and Earths, 5%, it says, what is the duty of a Muslim in regard to the four devils? What why must Muhammad murder the devil? Or why must anyone murder the devil? And what is the duty of the in regards to the four devils? That whole thing is talking about, and I'm paraphrasing, that whole thing is talking about the kundalini and the four lower chakras being seen as the lower nature or the lower self, the devil itself. And it says right there that, you know, that is 100% wicked, weak and wicked, you know, and is a snake of a drafted type. And if it was allowed to live, then it would strike someone else. So that means that if you did not murder your lower ego, that fear, that lust, that jealousy, that envy, you did not murder those lower attributes of yourself, then you would take those attributes and through the whispering of your tongue, being that your tongue is a double-edged sword, you would pass that information on to others and impregnate them with that same spirit of jealousy, hatred, greed, and lust. So you have to kill it and murder it and conquer it within yourself. This is where you have to become Muhammad the Conqueror, as they would say. You know, and you have to, go ahead.
Yeah, I heard you say that, Muhammad was a title.
Right.
And Buddha was also a title, right?
All of them are titles.
Now, I heard you break down basically Jesus and the name of Jesus, but you never really, I never really heard you break down the Quran or Muhammad, if he was real or was he fictitious or an allegory.
Yeah, Muhammad was an allegory because the title itself, Muhammad, comes from out of Ethiopia, which the priesthood of the Egyptians or the Tamarans were the Ethiopians, what is known as the Tassedians or the Tanasi people, in which that they was the followers of Anu, and their names were Maur, M-A-U-R. They was the Moors. This is where the origin of the word Moor comes from. It's from that particular priesthood of the Ethiopians, because if you get the wonderful Ethiopians of the Kushite Empire written by Drusilla Houston, she states within her book that the Kushites was known as the Kush Moors, M-O-R. So there was one in the same priesthood. So this is where the word Moor originate from. This is why people want to say that they don't know where the Moors came from. Well, they came from the Ethiopian Egyptian priesthood. They was the bearers of the ancient mystery school. They was the teachers. This is why within the Stolen Legacy written by George G. James, he states that the Moors are the guardians of the information of the ancient Egyptian mystery school. And this is what you get from me is actually the information from the ancient Egyptian mystery school, at least part of it anyway. You know, so the thing is that Muhammad symbolized the title of happy, Happy Up the North was called Muhammad. In other words, Muhammad. He was called the Happy Up the North.
But I heard you say one time that Muhammad's real name was, I forgot, Mufasa Alim, something like that.
Right, it was Mustafa Alamin Abdullah Ibn Allah, or Ibn Abdullah, excuse me. All right, so that was the name in which that, the person in which that Muslims claim existed. However, if they're saying that he came from Ishmael, and Ishmael was the son of Abraham, then that is a fallacy because Abraham and Ishmael did not physically exist. If you go to the Bible, you go to Galatians, the 4th chapter, the 22nd through the 26th verse, it tells you that Abraham, his wife, Sarah, his other wife, Hagar, in which that gave birth to Ishmael, Sarah gave birth to Isaac to Jacob, but Jacob became known as Israel, that they were allegories. Now, you look up the word allegory. It means the synonym for allegory is symbols. It was symbolic. You look up the word allegory, it also means fictional characters, which did not physically exist. So anybody trying to claim lineage to Abraham, whether it's Christianity, Islam, or Judaism, are actually fictional.
Now, Abraham, when you break Abraham down, what does that break down to the name?
Ab, Ra, Sun. So Ab, Heart, Ra, Sun, Ham, Black.
Gotcha.
It was an ancient Egyptian name.
That was also a title?
Yeah, that's a title. Abraham symbolizes the core of the black sun, in which, in other words, he's talking about melanin, in which that is excreted from the pineal gland. That's why it's called, that's why the third ventricle within the Sanskrit is known as the cave of Brahma, because the word Abraham and Brahma, or Brahman, mean, is the same word.
Mm.
What was Abraham's original name? It was Abram. How you spell it? Abram. Abram. Now spell Brahma.
Brahma. A-B-R-A.
Right. Brahma is within the Sanskrit.
Oh,
B-H-R-A-M. Brahma. And then you have the word Brahmin, in which that Abraham is also taken from. And how we know, because Abraham's wife is called Sarah. Well, what is Brahma's wife name called within the Sanskrit teachings? Saraswati. And what was Sarah's original name in the Bible? It was called Sarai, S-A-R-A-I. Then they changed it to a H, which became S-A-R-A-H. Well, what is, how you spell Saraswati, who's the wife of Brahma? S-A-R-A-S-W-A-T-I. Saraswati. So that's no coincidence that Abraham and his wife is based off the characters of the Sanskrit teachings of Brahma and Saraswati. And who is Brahma and Saraswati based off of? Well, you go back to ancient Egypt once again, and you will find that that is Ra and his wife, Rayet.
So the Bible is, are any characters real in the Bible?
Yes, there's a couple. Now you have Taharqa, in which that is mentioned. Who was a Cushite king? It is mentioned within the Bible, in which that comes from out of Ethiopia or Abyssinia. You also have characters in which that these fictional characters were based on, like Akhenaten, Unten, who was known as Amenhotep the Fourth. David and Solomon stems from, and those particular books of King Solomon and King David stems from the teachings of Akhenaten. Matter of fact, the Psalms 104 is identical to Akhenaten's hymn.
I'm talking about that weren't metaphors for somebody else. Maybe like Herod, or let's say like, yeah, Solomon. Solomon is also fictitious or also an allegory.
Right. Solomon is, like I said, is based on Amenhotep III and Amenhotep IV, who is Akhenaten or Unten. That is symbolic to David and Solomon. In other words, when you read the hymns or the songs of Akhenaten or his father, Amenhotep III, you will see that they are nearly identical to the Psalms and the Proverbs and ecclesiastical teachings of the Old Testament, who is supposed to have been written by David and Solomon. But they actually existed during the 18th dynasty. However, Solomon and David did not.
Gotcha. Well, I appreciate it. I'm still doing my breath techniques, my 6363.
All right.
All right. I'll be on the line.
All right. Peace, brother. Appreciate you. Thank you.
All right. No problem.
All right. We got area code 704. Area code 704 on the line. Peace.
Hotep, brother.
Hotep.
It's 19, 24L. What's up?
Peace, God.
What's up, baby boy?
What's up with you?
I've been listening to you, boy. You doing your thing, like always. Bismillah, Ibrahim, Arahim, you know what I mean?
All right, no doubt. Trying to get it. Trying to wake him up, right?
Hey, you did a magnificent job with the brothers just now.
Well, appreciate that, Op.
Yeah, no doubt, man. I'm loving this, man. I didn't know it was like this, boy. You got to send me these every time you do it. I'll be on here.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, we on here every week, 8 o'clock Wednesday, every week.
Okay, I'll be here now, man. I definitely will be here.
Oh, yeah, this is our, this is going into a year and a half of us doing this right now. It started around my birthday of last year, and we still keeping it popping.
Oh, that's what's up. How you coming with them tracks I gave you?
Man, I was never able to open them up.
You weren't?
Nah, that's why I wanted to come down there to you.
Oh, man, let me tell you what. I still got the folders sitting right here on my, what's called, this is what I'm going to do. Text me your email again, and I'm going to send them to you in a zip file.
Gotcha.
And then you'll be able to open them up. I'll zip them up and then send them to you. What I'll probably do is send them to you broken down, or either I'll send them to you in auditory. In your email, I sent them like 3 or 4 at the time, because you had like 20-some tracks, so.
Right.
I'll send them to you. Yeah, okay. you ain't got to worry about that.
I appreciate that, God.
But,
you want to build on?
What you was talking about, this is powerful right here. But, my cousin, he just hit me, because, I put him on the signs, years back. And he just hit me with something from Yahoo talking about the Sasquatch, which we know him as Yetis or what have you. And he sent me talking about, Doc was right about that. And I was like, I hit him back and told him, yeah, I already know all of that. You know all of that. You know what
right.
I'm saying? But,
right.
Now all of a sudden, there's been like all these extra sightings of what's really going down. You know
right.
what I'm saying? Like they've been seeing them. Even more, in the day's time. You know what I'm saying? Like it's been like a reoccurrence. Like they got shows about it and everything else. And like the day on Yahoo, they were talking about that Bigfoot was part of human on DNA
right.
study.
Right. You know where that comes from? That comes from the fact that the Sasquatch or the Bigfoot, the Yeti. all of that is part of the Neanderthal branch. And
right, exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so and that was part of the experiment that, that made who we were.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? When it was dealing with the mitochondrial DNA, you know,
right.
And what we're trying to do to go to what is called modern Homo sapiens.
Right. Well, I would say this, is that it was, we utilized that as the gods. We utilized those genes to make the Albion. And so when you look and you do the research about, you know, Africans, and you will find that the Africans have no traces of the Neanderthal gene.
Right.
The European, however, and the Asians have between 2-4%.
Right, exactly.
You know, so that means that there was some serious tampering with the, like you said, the mitochondrial DNA and the genes at one particular time. As a matter of fact, you get Walter Scott's book, Hermetica. It
mm-hmm.
states in there that the worst thing that the Egyptians stated that the worst thing that we have ever done was create man in our image and after our likeness. Now, that
mm-hmm.
sounds exactly like the phrase in the Old Testament in Genesis, the first chapter.
Right, when it says that, you know, when become like he, them, or us, which they, you know, God never said he was satisfied. Well, the Most High never said, or New said never said he was satisfied with making
right.
who we were.
Right.
Which had to do with what happened with the experiment not being finished
right.
when Cain flew Abel.
Right.
You know what I'm saying, in the garden. So that's where that whole situation went.
Right, right.
So, yeah, yeah, yeah. Now, mm-hmm. the other thing I want to talk to you about, you know, everybody's talking about this, you know, how about the Mayans, which we know that the Mayans are our brothers and sisters and whatnot.
Right.
But you know, everybody is talking about how they, you know, because I saw what you put on the on Facebook today, you know, because I, like I said, even though I don't talk to you all the time, I'll be following what's going on. But you was talking about how they were talking about the 12-12-12 situation.
Right.
And it was, I forgot the name of, but you had this gold entity that was flowing through, and people were asking, was it angels or whatnot? It was called the Men something. I can't remember right off the top of my head, but I'm actually scrolling back on Facebook now because I said I was going to go look it up because I had never seen that before in the teachings that me and you did when we were at school, but. Explain that to me, because I think you know what I'm talking about.
Right. Well, we're talking about the orbs, if that's what you're referring to, the particular
yeah.
orb.
Well,
yeah.
What it was, you know how you had the, it was this gold thing with the writing and the inscriptions and everything that was on it that was flowing through, like, the air?
That was flowing through the air. I'm trying to think.
It was early today. It was like it was in outer space. I'm going to pull it down for you. Hold on. Just bear with me.
Okay.
Bullet, and it starts with an F, M-E-T something.
Oh, okay. I think you're talking about the macabre.
Not quite sure. Okay. Let me go to your. I found it, man. It's called a Metatron.
Metatron, yeah. All right. Metatron was one of the highest angels, one of the archangels. Some say that he was even greater than Michael. But what I've actually gone into as far as Jewish lore, Metatron is equated to Enoch. In Old Testament.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So Enoch, of course, was the so-called first human who walked with God and was not found any longer. In other words, he was translated or transformed, you know, from human into godhood as he walked with God to become one of the archangels. And, of course, you know, don't let that title God fool you, because it means El. And anyone who takes on the title El is an angel. And so Enoch became known as Metatron, even though the L isn't on there, the Atan part is, in which that, of course, we mentioned earlier that Atan is symbolic to the sun disk with the wings,
right.
symbolizing
mm-hmm.
the expansion of the mind. So Metatron would actually be you know, somebody to that expansion of the mind. Once you have reached 100% usage of your brain, you walk with God, and you do and you no longer have to be within the human form. In other words, don't have to incarnate any longer.
Mm-hmm.
If you choose not to, if you want to dematerialize and materialize, you can do so at will.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because that goes just like with Elijah. Elijah was taken up by God on a flaming chariot of Makaba.
Mm-hmm.
However, when you go and do the research, Elias had a portion of the spirit of Elijah based on the Old Testament and the Book of Kings and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you go and study in the New Testament, John the Baptist have a portion or is Elijah.
And mm-hmm.
when the disciples asked Jesus, well, who was John the Baptist? He said, oh, well, that was Elijah, the prophet of old, if y'all will accept that.
Right.
So, that's in the Book of John. So that's where all of this stems from, symbolic to the fact that once you reach 100% usage of the brain capacity, you have the ability in order to materialize or dematerialize or astral project or, you know, there's all these certain gifts you are able to develop. You know, like, for example, healing, psychic abilities, etheric sight, increased intelligence, you know, expanded awareness, enhanced sexuality, increased personal magnetism, bliss of nirvana, you know, the conscious connection with the source of the one, increased stamina, longevity, you know, and of course, you know, the SETIs, you know, which is, or the SIDHAs, which is known as the supernatural powers, spoken of within the Upanishads or within the Bible, which says the gift of healing, miracles, speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues, faith, knowledge, understanding, you know, gift of miracles, all of these things, you know, was speaking of or spoken of, you know, so that would equate to psychemistry, clairvoyance, clairaudience, clairsentience, clairguestance, which is the expansion of this touch, taste, smell, seeing, and hearing.
Right. We're dealing with the five senses.
Right, right.
We're also going into the four higher senses with equal nine.
Exactly. So that is all symbolic, and that's Metatron. That is that conscious. That's a title, just like Melchizedek is a title, just like Michael is a title, Jesus is a title, Muhammad is a title. All of these are titles of consciousness that you can obtain once you reach the sixth and the seventh chakra.
Right. And see, that's what people get misguided when they read the Bible, because they're looking at them as physical people.
Right.
But in all actuality, they are different states of higher consciousness.
Right. Exactly.
And that's what everybody gets misunderstood when it talks about when things are coming into place or when the Most High is coming back or what have you. It has to do with that it's coming back so far as in you, not in the physical form so far as
one
things are right. Or one mm-hmm. you're right, exactly. Or this one person is coming back. It's the collective mindset of everyone that is dealing with this information or this knowledge
right.
to go to the next world.
Right, it's the monkey theory. If you ever heard about the monkey theory, one monkey can actually be, you know, have a nut or something in which that he want to crack open, and he comes up with a new concept or a new way of doing it. Next thing you know, that new way of doing it travels throughout the whole, you know, clan of monkeys.
Right.
You know, it's called the 100 monkey theory. So now all the monkeys somehow know exactly how to do the same thing, but yet might not necessarily have been shown by that one monkey. It's a collective mind in which
right.
that transfers, in which that everyone in which that is associated with that one monkey elevates to that same level as that one monkey. So it can come through one, but it don't stay at one for very long because it travels through all of us who are ready for that conscious upliftment.
And that's what we always talk about, is like when we speak something into the world.
Right.
When we speak it, then it becomes viral to everyone.
Right. Exactly.
And then, you know, like if you speak something, then you're putting it into existence, and then from that point, the existence moves forward to everyone else. And then that's why sometimes if you don't have the means or the resources to get that particular concept out, then someone else comes up with it because you already spit it out to the world.
No doubt. No Exactly right. Because you had your opportunity. Gotcha. You're right, because you had your opportunity to be the one, right?
Right, when you thought of
right. Right, so that's
the right. Right, because we're all connected with, and we're all connected by our genes,
right.
Our DNA.
Right, exactly.
And it has to do with our melanin and our melatonin.
Well,
who we are.
That's why it's called intelligent. It's not called out-telligent.
Right.
It's called
right.
intelligent. Because
right.
in, and then tell, and then gene.
Right.
Intel, right. gene, intelligence. Intel, in other words, there's something in which that is telling or saying something forth inside your genes. It's called
right.
your ancestor,
right.
that little voice in which that you hear.
Right.
In which that oftentimes we don't listen to. That's intelligent.
Right.
When we listen to it, then you're intelligent. When you don't listen to it, you're dumb, deaf and blind.
And I guess that's why I've been living the way I've been living for the last 3 years when it comes to how, like, a lot of the stuff I've been telling you about what's been going on with me and so far as building, you know, building myself and opening my chakras to a certain point. That's why, like, now I don't even have to, like, all I have to do is, I don't say wish for something. I speak it in my mind and say, you know, I would love to be able to meet somebody that knows this. And the next thing I know, somebody brings somebody to my doorstep that knows exactly what I was asking for.
Perfect. Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? It's like you manifesting everything that you was asking for straight from your mind into existence.
Right. Exactly, and that's where we're supposed to be. But then, you know, that's a certain level in which that you reach once you have gone into your immortal body. If you were still
right.
one of these persons stuck in your four lower chakras or called the devil, then you wouldn't have that ability.
Right.
Matter of fact, you might
right.
be one of the ones who is trapped in, you know, one of the people who is trapped in the lowest between the first and the second chakra who's always complaining that God will never answer my prayer.
Exactly. And like I always tell my wife, you know, like, my wife here lately, well, I would say in the last 4 or 5 years, she has been, like, totally into a situation wherein she's like, you've been speaking this to me for 10 years. And, like, I keep seeing everything that you keep saying around me.
Oh, yeah. Well, you remember when we was in college, you know what I'm saying? 20 years ago, ain't nobody know nothing about no damn Illuminati. All of a sudden, now everybody knows. All the rappers know. Cat Williams knows. David Chappelle knows. Everybody know about the damn Illuminati now. But 20 years ago, if we spoke that shit on campus, what happened, God?
Everybody said we was crazy.
Thank you.
And guess what? Same thing. You remember I told you about the day that I came home in 1990 after me and you had really got tight? And I sat at the dinner table with my dad, and I was telling him certain things. And my dad actually got angry with me about, you know, I don't want to hear that, you know. But guess what? Here it is 20-some years later, and my father calls me now for information.
How did?
And I said, and guess what I do?
What's that?
I tell him what he wants to know.
There you go.
And guess what else I do?
What's that?
I do exactly what you told me as my master teacher. I said, don't believe me.
Check it out.
This is where you can go check it out for yourself. Because now, see, I don't have to be sitting with my father anymore because we got the World Wide Web.
That's right.
So where I know where it's at, go check it out. Matter of fact, let me send you the link. Check your email.
Right.
So he can be sitting in his chair. It's just like the masters that was in ancient Mishraim. You know how the brother was sitting in the king chair and he got the woman standing behind him, right?
Right.
Okay. He's sitting in the chair behind the computer looking at the screen, and we're no longer telling lies on the vision when you're speaking truth. Mom's standing behind him. They seeing it for themselves together.
Right. Perfect.
True marriage. You know what I'm saying? True
right.
marriage, true. Now I'm taking a generation that was lost into the know.
That's right.
That's power. And now
yeah,
I saved my mother and father. I saved my mother and father, and I am saving myself at the same time and saving my next generation, which is my two daughters and my wife.
That's right.
You know, so yeah, that's beautiful, man.
No doubt. But hold on,
yeah,
hold on. I'm gonna bring area code 302 on. I'm gonna try to get a discussional panel going on if you got time for that.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm listening. Go ahead. I'm here, man. I ain't going nowhere.
All right, area code 302. You on the line?
Yeah. Peace, God. This is Be Knowledge of Messiah.
Peace, God. How y'all doing tonight?
We good, and yourself?
I'm doing well.
I got a question that's actually from somebody. Dealing with somebody that has, you know what I mean, if you want to put a name on it, ADHD, they're having trouble seeing if they can't focus on something or if they're just not interested in a lot of things. So do you have any suggestions on any techniques to help that focus?
Yeah, well, first I have herbs in which that would help. You have what's called St. John Wort, W-O-R-T. You know, St. John Wort tea. You will want to start a regimen on that in order to calm the mind down, along with some chamomile tea. And what that does is make the mind manageable enough to stop from the racing and stop from being all surrounded by, you know, all the illusions being plagued. In other words, plaguing the mind. You know, the illusion of the outside world, the illusions of society, the illusions of whatever is going on, you know. And then the techniques in which that I would recommend is one of the techniques that we spoke about earlier. One of the brothers was saying 6363.
Right.
And that's actually sitting down and breathing in for a count of six, holding it for three, breathing out for six, holding it for three. And you would do that 100 times, once or two to three times a day, depending on you doing, you know, on what, you know, how much time you have. And that within itself will expand the auric field and remove any debris in which that is surrounded the auric field in which that has possibly plagued the individual. It also remove demonic possession, remove shells, disincarnated spirits from the auric field, negative thought forms, as they're also referred to as. Harmonics or whatever you want to refer to them as. All of these things sometimes become attached to the auric field based on our thought patterns and based on the thoughts of other individuals in which that is attempting to plague us. So this is the reason why for these particular sciences, you know, is to help our journey as much as possible, you know. So you definitely want to learn those particular techniques, you know. And I know a lot of this might sound spooky to cats, but this is real because you have people who think negative about you all the time. And if they think intensely enough, they can actually develop a body, a conscious body of some sort in which that can become attached to your auric field because they are thinking about you so hard negatively. And if you don't know how to cleanse yourself from it, then it can plague you. So one of the ways to cleanse the body is to take a sea salt bath, or either with Epsom salt to cleanse the auric field. All right.
That's information to know, God. And so yeah, she's listening, so I'm pretty sure that helped her. Thank you for that. Another just a quick question about me personally. Just doing simple meditation and breathing exercises when I'm just late before bed or in the shower or anything like that. I haven't been doing any specific breathing exercise in particular, maybe just in five, out five, or in three, out two, in three, out, something like that. But when I say, for lack of a better term, come back from a certain state, because I've been able to, you know what I mean, go certain places, I have a real heavy breath and I get nauseous and my heart is pounding. How can I stop that?
Oh, okay. I know what that is. That's actually a blockage within your heart and your solar plexus area, within your nervous system. So what you would want to do is relax your nerves so that it won't activate your heart. So what you want to do with that is find teas in which that'll relax. And just like we said, with the chamomile tea, as well as also the St. John Wort's, valerian, partiaco.
Okay.
These particular teas help calm down the nervous system. to regulate the nervous system.
That's good. That's what it'll be associated with. Like, I'll just be laying in the bed and I'm by myself, and if someone turns the light on in the room, it'll just mess everything up.
Right.
And I'll just, my heart start racing, I get nauseous, but yeah, it's mainly my heart. It's just a heavy presence in my heart.
Right.
So that happens mainly, but.
Right. Now, let me tell you the herbs that remove blockages in the heart. You have cayenne pepper, which is red pepper. You have garlic. And you have what is called hawthorn berry.
Mm.
Those three herbs together eliminates any problems with the heart. The heart racing, the heart palpitations, all of those things can be eliminated. Heart murmurs, all of those things can be eliminated. Prevention of heart attacks, strokes, all these things can be prevented by taking these particular herbs.
All right, I'm going to definitely do that. And any breathing technique you suggest just for meditation?
Yes, the breathing technique, which that you will want, is the relaxation breath technique, which is based on 4-7-8. You would breathe in for a count of four,
right?
Hold it for seven, and then breathe out for a count of eight. So breathe in four. So breathe in 1, 2, 3, 4. Hold it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Out for eight. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
That definitely works.
Right.
That definitely works. Yeah, I'll definitely do those and apply all that. You know me, I'm sorry. And you have anything to say?
Yeah, so with that, you breathe in. The four, you hold it?
Right. You breathe in for a count of four, hold it for a count of seven, then breathe out for a count of eight.
You breathe in for a count of four,
right.
Hold it for a count of seven,
right.
And blow out for a count of eight.
Right.
Okay, I got it. For how long? About an hour?
No, you can do it for about 20 minutes.
20 minutes?
20 minutes is excellent.
Okay.
Now, of course, if you got an hour, then you can do it for an hour, but 20 minutes is suffice.
Okay. All right, this Messiah on the line. Good to hear from you.
No doubt, God. Appreciate you calling in or getting on the line, Robert.
Absolutely. We always tuned in.
All right.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I'll be in touch with you later on tonight.
All right.
Peace.
Peace. All right, we got area code.
Peace.
309. Area code 309. You on the line.
What's going on?
Greetings, peace.
Yeah, peace to you. This Aleem show, right?
Yes, it is.
Oh, I'm sorry, I can't believe I got through. How you doing, brother?
Doing good,
Okay, I was just listening. I wasn't thinking I was gonna get through, but I just had a few questions, and I got like a court day coming up soon,
right?
And I just wanted to, you know, it's just for a little speeding ticket or something like that. And this is cop that's always just, you know, sitting in the same area and, you know, he just feeds off of anybody that's going, you know, going any type of speed limit over the speed limit. So
right.
I just want to know how to get the negative energy off me before I go into the courtroom and, face the peoples.
Right. What you want to do is get a cup of Epsom salt and soak in it for 20 minutes in order to cleanse your auric field.
Okay.
Then light a blue candle and say Psalms, and then say Psalms 8 over it.
Psalms 8?
Right, and which that deals with court issues. All right?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now, then also what you want to do is, say in your mind what you want to happen and see it manifest.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You want the ticket dismissed or disposed of? Then that's what you're saying all the way into the courtroom as you sit down throughout the whole time when they call your name.
You know what I'm saying?
I don't know if you have your nationality paperwork done. Have you had that done yet?
No, I actually haven't had it done yet. But
all right. So
me and my girlfriend, we want to get on that real soon, though.
All right. I'm going to have to tell you then how to do it then. What you want to do, I don't know, where you located at?
Oh, I'm originally from Peoria, Illinois, but me and my girl, we relocated to Indianapolis. So that's where I'm over in Indianapolis right now. That's where the court date is going on at.
Okay, so the court date is in Indianapolis. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
What you want to do, you want to send in what is called a special appearance affidavit.
Okay.
Just before you go in.
Mm-hmm.
Telling them that you are not there under general appearance, but you are there under threat, duress, and coercion.
All right.
And that they have to prove jurisdiction.
Okay.
Subject matter and person matter, or what is called personal.
Okay.
Okay, and you have all of this inside of this notice, in which that you're going to send in certified mail receipt.
Certified mail receipt, right.
You're going to send it in to the court. You're going to make sure that it goes to the clerk of court for that particular case and tell them to put a copy in your file.
In my file. A copy in my file, okay.
That way the prosecution can see it also, as
mm-hmm.
well as pass that information on to the judge in the courtroom that day.
Okay. And so will they still have to respect that, even though, like, I'm still in that straw man term? You know, in that straw man capacity still.
Well, that's the reason why you have to you can still do your battle with it. Of course,
okay.
jurisdiction can be raised at any particular time period. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Beginning, during, or even after. If you have to appeal
mm-hmm.
it. If you have to appeal it, then you appeal it in open court, and they'll move it up to superior court. But that gives you
right.
some time if you don't want to pay it till that it can get dismissed. Don't never appeal your court case after the judge has already sentenced and you're leaving the courtroom. Always do it in open court. Your honor, I'd like to appeal your decision. So if it don't go your way, then you got a chance to go on and hit him in the head with that right then and there.
Right, okay. All right.
Well, now, also, what I would
go ahead.
Get on the internet and look up speed laws, because when you see a sign, are you supposed to speed up when you see the sign, or you speed up after you pass the sign?
Right.
That's one of the
okay.
questions that I would ask if it goes to a bench trial, and they put the the cop up there on the stand.
Mm-hmm.
If he shows up. I would have to ask that question. Sir, excuse me. Were there anyone else here on the day in question besides for yourself and me?
Mm-hmm.
And if he says no, then you would say that anything and everything that the prosecution is saying is hearsay. So therefore, it's inadmissible in a court of law.
Right. Okay.
And you sit their asses down. Because and everything that they say is hearsay after that, because they were not there. So what the hell they doing? What the hell they talking for?
Right. That's deep right there. That's deep, man. I appreciate that.
Right. So these are just some things that can be done. If you want to see, how well these things work, because I have dozens of them between my wife and I of us. Beating these people in court with no driver's license, no insurance, no registration, false documents, saying our affidavits
mm-hmm.
are false, all types of things, man. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, I know.
And we beat them every single time. Using the same arguments, because our affidavits has been filed at the county recorder, though. So that's one of the things that you need to do. You and your girl need to get your nationality documents done so that y'all can be able to have something to stand on as far as saying, look, I'm outside your jurisdiction. You don't have no authority here whatsoever. And if you
mm-hmm.
do, and if they say, well, where do you live? I live in my body.
Exactly.
You don't live in a house. If you leave the house, do the house die?
Right.
So you don't live in a house.
Mm-hmm.
But if your soul leave the body, don't that shit die?
Yeah, long gone.
So that's where you live. The God, the body, the body is the temple of God. The temple is the house,
mm-hmm.
the flesh. The mosque, the temple, the synagogue. That's the real, that's all of that. That's the church. And if you leave that church, which is your soul, leave that church, that body, then that body will die. But if you walk out that house, the house don't die.
True.
So you don't live in a house. You don't live in a location.
Mm-hmm. Deep right there, I appreciate that.
You don't live to 325 Eston Street, Milwaukee, whatever, you know, 2345. That ain't where you live. You know, so these are the things in which they get at you on in order to trick you up in the court system so that you can say, I understand. And if you say you understand, then you become liable for the bond which is attached to that broken statute that they claim that you violated.
Mm-hmm.
Always say, when they ask you the question, do you understand the charges being brought up against you, you say no. And then you give them the reasons why. Number one, even if you haven't done your nationality paperwork yet, you can still use the Dred Scott case law, which states that Negroes and those of African descent are not citizens of the United States, nor would they ever be.
Exactly.
That alone shows jurisdictional issues. Because if you're not a citizen of the United States, then what are you? Because as far as I know, the United States is of America. America is not of the United States, so one have a superior position. So if you're not a United States citizen, then that means you must be an American citizen. So that if that's the case, then that means you are above a U.S. citizen.
Right.
So therefore, they have no jurisdiction because anything in which that you have is nothing more than a privilege. A driver's license is a privilege.
It's true.
So these are things in which that you can use, brother. All right?
All right. I appreciate that, man. And I'll be trying to get on that cruise next March. I heard about coming up. So.
Oh, yeah. March 21st through the 25th. Definitely get your monies ready and come on. Be ready for that. And for everybody who don't know what he's talking about, we have the United Washington Cruise to the Pyramids in Cozumel, Mexico. And the only thing you need is a birth certificate and an ID. All right? So if you don't have a passport, you can still come, once again, with your birth certificate and your ID. That's all you need. If you do have a passport, then that's fine. You can still get on. But if you don't, once again, all you need is a driver's license or ID and a birth certificate. So that's it. All right? And that's going to be March 21st through the 25th. And we're going to have a good old time, for real. You know, you're going to go and see the Omex, you know, and the brother was talking about the Mayans and how much they mentioned the Mayans. Brother 19 was talking about that earlier, how they keep talking about the Mayans, but they don't never talk about the Omex. Matter of fact, when my wife went to Chesimisa, we asked the tour guide the question, well, what about the Omex? He said, oh, well, they're the mothers of civilization, but we don't know too much about them. Next question.
Wow. A real bias.
But, and he did and he did it just like that. I mean, I'm like, damn, okay, you really don't want to answer the questions, do you? So this is the type of games that these people are playing. So we have to go and see our ancestors' relics and artifacts and pyramids and mounds and all these things that they have left us to, for us to now awaken and come back into knowledge yourself, okay? So come on. It's the United Washington Cruise to the Mexico Pyramids, known as the Omec. And if you're part of the lineage, which most of you are, over 85% of you are, then you need to bring your behinds on and check it out. All right, so we're going to go to the next caller. Appreciate you, brother, for coming on.
All right, thank you. Appreciate it, bro.
All right, peace. You got area code 804. Area code 804. You're on the line.
Peace, God. How you doing?
Peace.
Right, all right. I'm good. I'm great. I'm great. I just have a question for y'all, Lee.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm trying to get some employment right now, and I just stopped blowing trees. You know, it ain't been long enough for me to pass a test.
Oh, I got you. Golden Seal or either Chaparral, brother. You might
Chaparral.
Want to go right. Chaparral is probably better because Golden Seal, they I heard that they check for, but Chaparral is one of the blood cleansers, and it can cleanse it out your system within less than 3 days, bro.
Heard.
Yeah, so Chaparral, Chaparral. get that and drink as a tea like 3 times a day and go on to flush your system out.
Great. Now, where I get that from, GNC store?
Yeah, you can get that from GNC or either Vitamin Shop.
Great, great. That's what's up, brother. I appreciate that because I'm finna go in and try to get me a job due to the child support thing. You know, I got to go to court for that. So trying to go ahead and do that before they try to put me in behind bars come February.
I got you. But don't worry, we got something for that too. Call me back or either call me at 252-257-3588. You know, we can even help you with that situation too, bro.
Thanks, brother. I appreciate that, Aline.
All right, peace out. All right, we got area code 770. Area code 770, you're on the line.
Greetings, Dr. Bay.
Greetings.
How are you? My name is Ruby, calling from Georgia.
All right, how you doing today?
Good, enjoying the show as always. I'm interested in your classes that you have and just wanted to find out exactly. I went on your website. I did see some things, but could you kind of give me some more information exactly what to expect?
Well, we have a new website. It's www.DrAlimElbey.com. So www.DrAlimElbey.com, and you can go on there.
Okay.
And we got a lot of information on there, as well as also the classes. We have 2 classes. We have the alternative healing classes, in which that we teach a lot of this information in which that is every Sunday and every Tuesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And we will start those classes back up after the so-called holy days, January the 6th, that's Sunday.
Okay.
Then we also have the indigenous law classes in which that we teach this information, which that I've also been talking about, you know, for the last couple of brothers that have been on here who have issues dealing with that. And we teach those classes every Monday and Thursday at 8 p.m. Mm-hmm. in standard time. So these are the classes in which that are available. So if a person want to know indigenous law, then they can check out those classes. Or if they want to know alternative healing, they can check out those
mm-hmm.
classes. So, you know, I don't know which ones you're interested in.
Well, at this time, the alternative healing, will that also include the science of breath?
Yes, that includes everything. Matter of fact, you go through Qigong, Tai Chi, Reiki, Pranic Healing, which is Pranayama, Kundalini Yoga. We go into many, many different facets of sciences, such as metaphysics, history, esoteric teachings, the various religions around the world and how they all connected to the one source, which is ancient Egypt, which is actually Kushite, or the
mm-hmm.
Ethiopians, and how that information spread it throughout the diaspora.
Okay.
And some even say that, you know, of course, Atlantis and Lemuria or Hyperborea, or what is also known as Pangaea or Asia or Mu. So we go into everything, and even off the planet, you know, to the last, you know, planet that we was on, which was Mars, prior to come here, according to the Amazulu people, and prior mm-hmm. to this one, according to the Dogon, the constellation Sirius. So, I mean, we go into everything that we possibly can and show how everything is one and how it's all linked and connected.
Okay. Sounds good. And how, where do I sign up for the cruise? Is that on your site as well?
Yes. That is also on the site, as well as also you can just give us a call at 252-257-3588.
Mm-hmm.
That's 252-257-3588. And we can give you more information concerning that. Or you can go
mm-hmm.
to my page. If you want to, you can go actually to my page, Facebook page, and you can see it. And if you have a book, Facebook, then you can send me a request, friend request, or I might already be your friend, I don't know, and I can send you a copy of the cruise flyer.
Okay. And I do have a question for you, if you could kind of help me and, you know,
mm-hmm.
Give some light on this.
Yes.
I went on a trip with another host to the Sphinx to read.
Right.
The Akashi Records. When I got there, Well, this is the second time. The first time there was nothing in my records, but the second time I got there, I went there, and I held my folder to my chest. The room, when I got there, the room that I was in was golden. It was lit in this golden orange, real warm color. So one of the records I pulled up, I put to my chest, and my whole body became golden, but I couldn't open it. So I checked another record. I was able to open that, and I saw some symbols. I'm not going to go through that. But it was just kind of funny because when I was listening to one of your other shows, you talked about the golden body.
Right.
And I was just wondering if that had anything to do with what I experienced.
Yes, it does. As a matter of fact, the more that you master the Kundalini energy and the subtle bodies, you can actually develop what's called the golden body, in which that you can use as a vehicle after you leave the physical body, or either upon the death of the physical body within 3 days, you can take over what is called the golden body with intact, your consciousness still intact inside mm-hmm. that golden body. So you don't lose consciousness. In other words, you are immortal. And if you choose to, you can materialize and dematerialize at will.
Okay.
You know?
So I was just wondering, could that have been why I was not able to open that record to you?
Right, because you haven't reached that level of consciousness yet, but yet you do concept and you are aware of it. So that's why you was able to see the light and feel the energy. But in order to activate it, it comes through practice and it comes through the development. So you want to practice Qigong. You want to practice Tai Chi. You want mm-hmm. to practice pranic healing or pranayama. And it's not every single facet, but certain keys from these particular exercises. If you need to, you want to go and see my grandmaster, Sunyata Saraswati, who can initiate you into the cosmic cobra breath technique. So mm-hmm. these are things that you can definitely do, you know.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So can I call back on this number and speak to you more about?
Yes, on the number that I gave you, 252, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
That's my home number.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Bay.
All right. Appreciate you. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. All right. Area code 561. Area code 561, you're on the line.
Hello?
Yes, please.
Please, doctor. This is Henry. We talk all the time on Facebook.
Yes.
This is
Brother Teacher Imhotep. Yes.
Hey, what's going on? I just wanted to put my shout outs out there. You know how you change your life and, you know, your teachings and, you know, right in exact, you know, right in line and in tune with the cosmos, you know?
I'm trying
to put that out there in the air.
Right. Appreciate that.
Yeah. Something I wanted to ask you about, which I already asked you before, but I don't remember what was the answer that you gave me. Sometimes, you know, when I'd be inside the tub and I would submerge myself, you know, and I feel like that there is some type of, sometimes I don't feel comfortable submerging myself in a tub of water, like my stomach and my body would begin to shake. So I wanted to see if you had some insight on that.
Right. Well, that could come from a past life issue. You know, you possibly could have been drowned in a past life. So therefore, mm-hmm. there was some type of fear in which that is associated with the water, or either you could have went through a traumatic experience inside the womb of your mother during the mm-hmm. 9 months inside of her amniotic fluids, which is water, you know what I'm saying? You know, and it could have been something traumatic in which that she experienced, you know, from things dealing with the outside world, but you was in her, and so therefore you experienced it too. So these things can happen, but the whole point is to eliminate the fear factor. Now, how you eliminate fear, you can learn what is called ETF, emotional tapping what's called emotional emotional tapping. And what you would do, you can tap on the side of your hand. You can look it up on the internet. You can look it up on YouTube. EFT, I think it's called EFT. I'm not mistaken. Emotional feelings transfer and tap and transfer or something like that. And what you would do is hit the side of your hand, hit your thumb area, your eyes, around your eyes, your nose, your lip, your collarbone area. And what that does is by doing these emotional taps, it eliminates frustration, fear, all these pent-up emotions that we have. You can learn that technique. You can also learn the relaxation technique that we made mention of, the 4-7-8 technique. You breathe in for a count of four, hold it for seven, breathe out for eight, in which that helps with the relaxation and the nervous system, so hence it helps with the fear factor. So these are the things that you can do. The herbs that you can take, dealing with fear and dealing with the nerves, once again, you can take valerian root. You can take St. John wort. You can take willow bark. You can take fenugreek. You know, these are different herbs in which that can be taken in order to help with the fear. Now, fear is stored within the kidneys, all right, because the adrenal gland sits directly on top of the kidneys. So there's herbs in which that you can definitely take for the kidneys. One is dandelion and also milk thistle. So not only does it help with the kidneys, but it also helps with the liver. Anger is stored in the liver. So you want to eliminate the fear and anger, and that will help with the situation in which that you're talking about, and you will be able to, and you won't have no problem, you know, dealing with that again, brother. So, you know, these are the things in which that you can do and which that can definitely help, okay?
Wow, that's really deep, because I was actually a preemie, you know, and my doctor told my mom that she had a tumor within her tubes.
Right.
And this prophet came over to her like a couple of days later, which she's supposed to have had this operation to remove this tumor, which was me. But someone came over to her and told her that you are pregnant, you know, and she aborted. Say again?
I said she was pregnant with you in her tubes.
Right, right. So this is right around the exact lines which you was talking about,
right,
where there must be a dramatic experience within the
embryonic fluid, right, within her.
Right, within that part of my conception.
Right.
So this is probably what is probably triggering.
Right. Now let me tell you this too. In order to remove the fear factor from that experience, you would have to go back. You have to go back in your mind to that particular time, and based on that event that you just told me, you would have to release it. You have to say to yourself that you released that experience. And there's a symbol in which that you can use if you learn the science of Reiki. Look up Reiki, R-E-I-K-I, Reiki, which is called universal force energy. And the symbol is called Hanshishishonen. You have Dekomeo, you have Hanshishishonen, you have Seheki, and you have Chokurei. The symbol that you want to focus on is the symbol in which that goes back in time. And that symbol is Hanshishishonen. Hun, H-O-N, Sha, S-H-A, Sho, S-H-O, Shin, S-E-N, Nin, E-N-N. So
can you actually shoot that to me on my
Yeah, once I get back on Facebook, yeah, I can get on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because this is some real deep stuff, because no one was ever capable of telling me what was going on with me, because when I was younger, I used to love swimming, you know, swimming and everything else. But then when I got older and I realized me laying in the tub, you know, laying on my back, you know, then these events, sort of like I could not breathe or things was happening to me, like I didn't understand what was going on in me. You know, I thought I was possessed with something, you know.
Nah, it's the remote suppressed memory. So
yeah.
You had suppressed when you was younger, so you was able to, I mean, children are more powerful than adults.
Right, right, absolutely.
You know, so you was able to overcome it at that time, but as you age, what happened is that the brain begins to, I guess you're going to say, atrophy in a sense. And the organs, you know, based on all the accumulation of the debris around your auric field, it begins to start taking over if you don't cleanse your auric field frequently. And so that energy can begin to, you know, that negative energy can begin to plague the human body and persistent organs based on how weak they are. So these are just some of the things that you definitely want to master. So I'm going to shoot that information over to you once I get back on Facebook. And, you continue asking me questions or whatever you need to know based on the email and what you're going to do your research, okay?
Okay, Hotep.
Hotep, brother. Appreciate you, brother. Teacher M. Hotep.
Same.
All right, we got area code 951. Area code 951. You're
looking like great, man. I'm looking right at a fucking UFO. It's like far away, but I'm looking at that shit traveling, and it's not a plane. You feel me? It's not a plane. I see that shit so clear.
Are you talking? Hello?
Where you at? Where we at, bro? Hey. Area code 951. Area code 941. You on the line?
Oh, sorry. Peace.
Hey.
I have somebody on the other line with me who's listening with me.
Oh,
but
okay.
I have a. This is a clean day. I'm sorry.
Queen.
But I had a question. Well, I just kind of want your insight on something.
Yeah.
I've been real deep into my dreams lately. I've been doing my dream journal.
Right.
And the more and more I get into it, the more I have deja vu. Like,
yeah.
I at least have deja vu at least twice a day. And I'm not sure if that's... And I've been able to recall memories, like, from 3 years old. Like, the more I do my dreams, the more I remember a lot of things.
Right.
But I seem to have deja vu, like, 3 to 4 times a day or twice a day at the very least.
Right.
And I don't know what it's from or if I should be paying attention to it. But,
yeah, well, deja vu experiences come from the fact that your mind has the ability in order to travel into the future and detail future events. One way of doing it is called remote viewing, and another way of doing it is called astral projection or astral travel.
See, that's what I've been doing, too. I've been practicing different techniques to do that, but I haven't been able to do it.
Oh, yes.
I've been able to have lucid dreams but not actually be able to do the astral projection, but I've been working on it for like the last couple months.
You have. You're not remembering because there's a veil in between the soul coming out of the body or the spirit coming out of the body and traveling into the future. Because you can't have deja vu experiences unless that happens. So if you especially
have I'm just not remembering.
Right, you're not remembering. So that's the problem in which that is going on. So if you are having deja vu experiences, that is coming from the fact that you have already traveled into those particular timelines, and you are bringing those particular timelines back, you know, in which that you're able to see what is going on, and you're able to experience those timelines. And so you're saying deja vu, you're saying like, you know, like, oh, wow, you know, I'm in this particular event. I've been here. I've seen this. I've felt this. You know, and the reason why is because you've actually gone before into an alternative timeline, and you actually experienced those particular things. Normally what happens is that certain events, if you can remember, sometimes they're supposed to have been negative, but because you have remembered, then they don't become negative. They'll stay neutral or either become positive.
Okay. That's cool, because I've been able to do it so often that I can, like, before they speak, I'm able to know what they're saying. But do you have any techniques, like, to help me remember it?
Yeah, you have to strengthen your oral skills. You have to strengthen your auric field. So we recommend the 7-1-7-1 breath technique. You breathe in for a count of 7, hold it for 1 count, breathe out for 7, hold it for 1 count. And what that does, and you do this 100 times a day, and once you finish, as a matter of fact, once it gets to about 100, you will feel your auric field expand 15 feet outside of you as compared to the average person with only 3 feet. So by strengthening your auric field, what happens is that you're able to encompass more memory coming being channeled down from your oversoul, which has your incarnated past lives in it.
Okay, can you say that one more time? Repeat it. Breathe in 7 and
right.
Hold
seven,
it for
7 seconds in, 1 second, hold it. 7 seconds out, 1 second, hold it.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate it so much.
All right.
All right, peace.
Peace. Peace. We got Eric Code 314. Eric Code 314, you're on the line. This is Brother L.
Yes, sir. Brother Peace, Dr. Arlene.
Peace, Doc. How you doing today?
I'm doing great. Doing great. I'm in the process of moving, but I'm doing okay. I've been hearing your show from the beginning all the way almost to the end now.
Right.
I was listening to you and the brother was talking about the Quran and how, really, I'm used to listening to how people always decipher Christian, the Bible, and Judaism, but never Islam.
Right.
Never Islam. And like I said before, I think I told you before in the last show that how Muslims, even among Muslims, this is something very hard to do, to even to go to a mosque. Well, really, I wouldn't even go to a mosque and say some of the things I've learned, you know.
Of course not.
No, yeah. They'd probably run me out of there.
That's stuff for law.
Yeah, so, but what I was listening to also, what you were talking about, Muhammad,
right,
as being also an allegory.
Right.
As well as Peter,
right,
and Joseph and Jesus.
Right.
And Abraham,
right,
and the like, you know.
Right.
So,
And that's not me saying it. That's the Bible. That's the Quran saying it.
Okay.
If you go to, like I said, Galatians, the 4th chapter, the 22nd through the 26th verse, it says that Abraham, his wives, and his sons are allegories.
Uh-huh.
Go to the 3rd chapter in the Holy Quran, Surah Imran.
Uh-huh.
In it, that portion of this book is allegorical. Other portion of it is decisive. But
right,
Allah reveals to those that he wants and those in which that are who are men of knowledge. However,
yeah,
there are those who want to interpret the book, you know what I'm saying, and its allegorical parts. And they interpret it in order to mislead people. Now, this is in the Quran. This isn't me. I didn't write that.
Right, right.
So the question,
right,
to Sunni Muslims, Shiites, or whoever, or to whoever, the question would be, well, what parts are allegorical, brother?
Okay.
So this is what your book says right here. And once they can't answer it, because they don't know that the portions are spoken of within the Bible.
Right. Like,
now, once you know that Abraham is allegorical, then how can any of them exist? Being that Ishmael supposedly came from Hagar, who was the wife of Abraham, but she's allegorical. And if he's allegorical, then of course he couldn't impregnate an allegory.
I've heard him talking about King Solomon and his 1,000 wives or concubines or something.
Right.
But
right,
I found out they were talking about the sun and the stars and the solar system.
Right, but it's also even more talking about the 1,000 lotus petals, in which that when the Kundalini energy comes up to the crown of the head, you gain 1,000 petals in your crown.
Oh, okay.
So that
is the first I heard of that one.
Right, so that's the 1,000 women in which that you as Solomon, the wise man, becomes married to.
Okay.
Because it represents the opening and activation of the crown chakra, the 1,000 petals.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah, so that's where that comes from.
Wow.
Now, externally, you know, you're talking about astrology, you're you know, dealing with astro theology, then yes, it deals with the sun and the particular stars.
Right, okay.
But internally, you know, dealing with the internal sun, which is the Kundalini, and as it crosses the sky from the east onto the west, so shall coming up the Son of Man be, then it's talking about the 1,000 petals at the crown chakra.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I also listened to what you were saying about the brother. He said he had a problem with the child support.
Right.
Yeah. He can get something done about that.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Well, me, brother Yada Bay, we've been studying and how to write up affidavits. You know, I know brother Rudra Soot.
Right.
I got a brother out of that.
Right.
You know, so Yada Bay had got his uncle.
Right.
Off of some kind of legal. Some kind of legal situation.
Right.
So, you know, this stuff, a lot of this stuff does work.
Oh, yeah, no doubt about it.
I'm just letting the people that are listening right now, this thing does work, what Dr. Eileen was talking about.
Oh, and
he can help you.
Oh, yeah.
He can help you. Just give him a call.
Yep. Well, I appreciate you, brother. I'm glad you finally got a chance to come on. We was going through a list of them tonight. We don't normally have this many questions, huh?
Yes, sir. I think I called too late, I think, because I called about 5 minutes to 7.
Oh, okay.
I guess everybody must have got ahead of me or some kind of way.
Right, right.
So I said, maybe he's going to let other people talk besides me, you know. So I didn't know what was going on.
I was trying to get you in there as being co-host as usual, but everybody kept calling.
Yeah, everybody kept excuse me. Everybody kept calling.
Right.
So I said, well, okay, whatever. I just stay on the line, you know.
Right.
And just keep listening to what you were talking about.
Right.
And so, you know, but I'm definitely here.
Well, I appreciate you, brother.
Every Wednesday.
Right. All right. Well, we getting ready to end the show. Appreciate y'all coming on, checking us out.
First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right, all right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
Got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence, an indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence, an indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages for us to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And
what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.